Hey everybody, DU Beat is in conversation with P. Sainath, acclaimed journalist, Magsaysay awardee and founder editor of People's Archive of Rural India. You are the grandson of the fourth president of India. What could have been a relatively comfortable life for you? You could have taken the easier road. What is it exactly that compelled you to become the person that you are and spend, say, like 10 months on the road with farmers across the country?
Well, it's not only with farmers, it's with agricultural laborers, it's with artisans, it's with fishing communities. But a lot of it has been with farmers in recent times because of the agrarian crisis and the incredible pressure that has led to the suicides of more than 3,10,000 farmers in 20 years between 1995 and 2015. Now, if you're a journalist who understands journalism the way I do, which is that journalism is about the reporting has to be about the everyday lives of everyday people, then I think it's quite logical to do what I do. I don't see what I do as any major sacrifice. I enjoy what I do. I don't suffer for it. Though the one thing that has been utterly miserable and the only thing that I've done in journalism that I can say I didn't enjoy one minute was breaking the stories on the farm suicides and creating those. Those have been heartbreaking. But otherwise, my work as such is what I do. I'm doing what I like to do. Now, if you're now rural India gets on the average front page of a national daily, rural India gets 0.67% according to the Center for Media Studies daily. 69% of your population gets 0.67% of the coverage on the front page of a newspaper. You should actually be asking journalists why they cover urban India or metro India so much rather than what takes them to rural India, because most newspapers and channels do not have, and none of them has a full-time national level rural India correspondent. Or, you know, agriculture correspondent is somebody who covers the agriculture ministry in Delhi or in the states, not somebody who covers farming and farmers and mandi. For me, agriculture is about people and livelihoods, not about agribusiness and ministries. So why we do what we do. I think I'm doing what is the what should be normal.
What should be the norm rather than what is the exception?
Yeah.
Within the Indian farming sector in general, or within the unorganized labor sector, who do you think are the worst sufferers? Is it gender? Is it caste? Is it the people at the bottom of the hierarchy? And who are the people at the bottom of the hierarchy?
Obviously, it's people at the bottom, but you know,
Kinjal.
I don't like doing rankings of victimhood. You know, the fact that he is more miserable than you are doesn't mean that you are in great joy, right? So it's not a good idea to rank people according to victimhood. That said, the the rural women laborers and women farmers, and particularly young and old ones, experience the greatest levels of distress because they do so on multiple fronts. A Dalit woman, say, for an agricultural laborer, Dalit woman, carries what people call a triple burden of caste, class and gender. Yeah, she belongs to the bottom of the rung in class society, is cast outside the ladder in caste society, and is, by virtue of being a woman and a Dalit woman, is fair game for anybody to harass, humiliate. Okay. So caste, class and gender render those amongst the most vulnerable sections of our society. In India, more than 60% of the work in agriculture is done by women. But we don't recognize them as farmers. When we say farmer, you think of a man and plow, or if it's Punjab, you think of a man on a tractor. You don't think of the work women do.
You don't think of the clay potting and the dishes washing and... I mean, Madhukeshwar wrote an essay about it.
You don't think of the paddy transplantation, you don't think of the dairying, you don't think of the livestock. And as many millions of men have moved out of agriculture, migrated out of the village or out of the profession and to other sectors within the same village, as that has happened, more and more women, their work has doubled, their labor has doubled. They were doing livestock and dairying, and now suddenly they are being forced to take on crop agriculture as well. And not only are they taking on crop agriculture, they are now, say a husband has, the male farmer has committed suicide, or he's migrated because there's no possibility of work in farming for him. So let's say the woman has lost either her husband to a migration or to a suicide. That woman is now suddenly looking after the kids, which she was doing, looking after the livestock, which she was doing, doing the full burden of crop agriculture, which was not fully her burden. She is negotiating with the money lender, with the bank manager, dropping the kids at school. Imagine the pressures. But we don't recognize women as farmers. We think of them socially as farmers' wives. And therefore, their suicides are not even counted.
Informal suicides?
They're not counted. About a small percentage of them. Because only if they have their name on the patta. So women farmers' suicides are counted as women's suicides. A general suicide.
By the way,
the largest group in Indian society committing suicide is women in the age group 14 to 29 or 14 to 39. It's women. Most of those women in the countryside are farm girls or agricultural laborers. Now, our prejudices towards women and our society reeks of prejudices towards women. Our prejudices towards women don't allow us to see them as property owners, because we don't give them property rights in land. Not legally, by custom and tradition, so-called tradition. So, the second is that, as I said, they do the bulk of work in agriculture.
Unrecognized work.
So, what happens as a result of that is that when you look at unpaid work also, at home and else, and on the farm, their own farm, the result of this is that the work participation data show us that women's participation in work is falling. Now, this is very funny. The amount of labor that women are doing has doubled, but their work participation rate is falling because we only accept as work that which is paid work. Now, if you look, Professor Jayati Ghosh, have you heard of her? Yeah, Professor Jayati Ghosh has done a recent paper on macroscan.com, which shows you that if you start taking into account the work that women do, if you factor that in, women are actually participating in the work in a greater share than men. Okay, because you don't accept a lot of work as work. You don't accept that as work. You don't accept their labor as work. And almost anything that women do, you call that unskilled labor. Please try doing paddy transplantation transplantation and see how unskilled it is.
On the 29th of September, the central government intends to celebrate something called Surgical Strike Day across universities in the country, including JNU, your alma mater. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts about the same? About military achievements being celebrated in academic spaces?
I already said this in the Safdar Hashmi Memorial Lecture on media. There was a very successful surgical strike. It was a surgical strike that removed, that entirely removed any last vestige of spine in the Indian media. Not the brain, because that had been lobotomized a long time ago by corporate ownership. Yeah. So it's a desperation that comes, please note that it comes 6 months or 7 months before elections. Maybe 3 months or 4 months before elections will be declared. Yeah. I guess they have to announce something, because what else do they have to celebrate? What do they have to celebrate? Your economy is tanking. The rupee is at its lowest in human history. In the history of that currency, it is at its worst vis-a-vis the dollar. Petrol is selling at 92 rupees a liter in Maharashtra, in Parbhani, 19 rupees in Mumbai. Your entire, one after the other, your grand schemes have been failures. So I guess they've got to do some dance, some song to take attention of those incredible failures. The RBI report has come out in the last month. The RBI report came out saying that showing you that demonetization was a complete disaster. So I guess when you're in that corner, you'd hold on to anything. And it's also a way of promoting a chauvinist, sensibility. Whereas, that's about it. They don't have anything to celebrate. I think they will create 3-4 other things to celebrate, apart, outside the military, not just in the military, but what have they done in agriculture? What have they done in industry? 78 of your largest companies are in default, are on the verge, are filing for bankruptcy. Dozens of your largest companies are in that process. Yeah, they're in the middle of the Rafael deal, which every day is stinking more. When you're in all this, you have to have something to take the attention of your failures.
You mentioned that this is chauvinistic in nature, the celebration.
No, I'm not. No. I'm saying the entire Sangh Parivar attitude to life is chauvinistic in nature. Okay? Everything they do, whether it's on women, whether it's the attitude in, or whether it's gender attitudes, whether it's this. The thing is that the military conflict itself, the army did what it had to do, or the military did what they had to do, which is to defend your borders. Now that was a border skirmish or a border, a border conflict, if you like. Yeah. I don't know what the big deal is about it. And why did you suddenly feel, when did this take place, and when are you celebrating? When are you creating the celebration?
They've asked the NSS, National Service Scheme, societies across colleges to celebrate it in a grand manner, make sure that it's felt in the universities. The circular went around.
A similar thing happened when, after the Kargil conflict, bringing all the widows onto television, many of whom were traumatized. Many of whom were traumatized, and having 30 flashlights on them, lights on them, etc. Let me tell you, this is not being done for the military. It's not being done for the army. I am very sure that the armed forces did not ask for any such thing. It's being done by the government to boost the sagging morale of its private troops. I don't believe that the armed forces asked for such a celebration. I think there would be several people in the armed forces who would be unhappy about your drawing attention to what were covert operations.
So the era of fake news seems to be here, I mean, with the credibility of journalism and of media houses being questioned every second day. Sometimes it has ground to it, sometimes it does not. When and how does one preserve the sanctity of journalism, especially, you know, independent journalism?
See, the thing is this, that there seems to be an illusion that fake news begins with social media. That's not so. There has been fake news since there has been news. It's that technologically the scope for it has become incredibly more vast. The major thing, and people distrust the so-called mainstream media. They distrust it. And that distrust is, I think, in many respects deserved. So it's fake news is, you know, it's not just something that happens in tweets and in Facebook. Though that is a very potent and very difficult to check fake news. That. But you've had, I broke the story in 2009 on the paid news scandal in this country with Mr. Ashok Chavan claiming an expenditure of 11,000 rupees on advertising in it. When there were, we collected 86 full pages in color of advertisements on him. Yeah, 86 full pages. Now that's fake. Okay, that's fake, but because it appears in a supposedly legitimate media, we don't make much of it. We called it paid news, and that is what it is. There are those who do it for money, and those who do it ideologically, and those who do it. It's a psychopathic thing for some people. Is it bad? It's terrible. Of course it is. But don't kid yourself that it's just something to be dealt with in social media. That is the point that you need to make. But its scope has enlarged incredibly with the technologies that run social media. Now the thing is this, the whole point of news and the problems with it, the lies with it, the fake with it, comes from people having monopolies over sources of news or over news media. Now, you know, the thing is, first of all, social media is, it's a terrible misnomer. It's wrongly named. It's anything but social. You're sitting here and talking to me about it because you're worried about how antisocial it can be. Right? I'm saying, first of all, that's a wrong name. Second is, it's a wrong name because you think, when you say social media, you think of something that you're suggesting that this is open and socially owned. It isn't. You're seeing every day the scandals involving Facebook. Now, the digital monopolies are the largest monopolies in history, and they are greater than any other monopoly. Why are they more different, say, from the monopolies in oil or aviation or shipping or television? Why are they digital monopolies more dangerous than any other monopoly? One is the extent of reach and monopoly. Yeah? Now, Google has 74% of all search. eBay has 68% of all online auctions. So, literally 5-6 people who are merging every day control all of this. But what becomes more dangerous, what makes them different from all other monopolies, is that these guys own your personal data. No monopoly in history before did that. A newspaper may have had a monopoly. Times or Hindustan Times may have had a monopoly in Delhi. They didn't have your personal data and they didn't own it. These guys own your personal data, they sell it, they traffic in it, right? And they lend it out, they rent it out to political processes, to vendors, to merchants. I call them human data traffickers. That's what they are. And that's what Facebook is facing. When I used to say this 3 years ago, a lot of people laughed. Now look at Facebook. It's been doing exactly that. It's been trafficking in your data.
So when you reach out to people in the rural areas, and when how do they essentially perceive you? Do they see you as somebody who's come from the outside to help them out? How do you make yourself one of their own?
That changes over many years. When you begin, you're a stranger. The point is, people will figure you out. They are curious about why you are there. What's there in it for you? They will figure out whether you are there for them or for yourself. Yeah. And you have to consider, am I doing this because I'm having a story and it's good for me? Or are you doing it because there are human beings who have a story to tell that you believe needs to be heard? It's something... People will figure you out. They will sort you out. Yeah. They will send... They will always... Most Indian rural people, regardless of what they think of you, will be very polite and gracious with you. But they may not necessarily open up and talk what they feel with you until they are comfortable. The first thing about talking to ordinary people and in the countryside is not language. That's not the first problem. That's the second problem. The first problem is credibility. That is, that they believe that you are someone who is there out of concern for their issues and their problems.
And not someone who will come, sweep in and move out.
Not a parachute journalist, as we call them. And that comes maybe when you are seen in the company of someone they know, their organization leader, some doctor who is doing free service there, some lawyer who is fighting their cases, but usually people from their organizations, their union organizers who have fought for them. When you are seen in that company, there is a degree of trust established. And from there, it's up to you how you take the trust forward or backward. Right? So over time, you develop your network. I think it happened quite fast in my case. But also, when I write a story, every story that I write from the rural areas, and I take photographs, I send it to the people in that story. I send them their photographs. If you go up onto the People's Archive of Rural India today, you'll see a story on Kudumbashri, the women farmers of Kerala, how they are fighting back against the floods. And despite the incredible damage, they don't look like the traumatized people of natural calamities that I've seen elsewhere. Now, whatever I have shot, written, and I'll be doing 3-4 stories on them. The first is on Pari. Will you see it? It's called Kerala's Women Farmers Rise Above the Floods. Whatever I've taken there, I will send them the photographs. I will send them the story on a DVD and the video on a DVD. Whatever. That's also trust, that you're not just making use of them and forgetting all about them.
Can you talk about Nation for Farmers, an initiative that has been kick-started by many amongst you, you being one? And what do you intend to achieve from it exactly?
See, it's not something that we are intending to achieve for ourselves. Farmers are many farm organizations under the rubric of the All India Kisan Sangharsh Coordination Committee, AIKSCC, have called for a big march on Delhi on November 28 to 30. When that happens, people will come from all over the country, but people cannot march from Kanyakumari to Delhi, right? So they'll come to within a particular distance of Delhi, 60 kilometers, 100 kilometers, and march from there. Now the farmers have given their march, they've made many protests. There was a gigantically successful march in Maharashtra, the Nashik to Mumbai march of the poorest farmers, mainly
the nation's eyes.
Yeah, that had actually they forced the nation's eyes. Many when the march started, only People's Archive of Rural India was there for them. After our first 2 days of reports, then the rest of the media realized that they were missing something big. Then corporate media came in, because I received 90 calls in one day from media on what the heck is happening. We didn't know. They knew, they just didn't take it seriously. They didn't think that a bunch of poor farmers, and not 40,000 of them, could march 182 kilometers without shoes and chappals because they were too poor to own them. So that happened. And when that, now the idea is that the farmers are up in protest. They are marching. They've had several marches. Our understanding, those of us who came together on August 22 in Delhi, our understanding was, how do we in the middle classes, professionals, occupations, teachers, students, how do we make ourselves relevant to the farmers' cause? That is how we look at it. So,
not how you help them, but how you assist them.
How do we make ourselves relevant to what is a very sincere, acutely democratic and serious struggle? Yeah, it's not our march, it's not my march. We are trying to mobilize in solidarity to the farmers' march. That is the aim. Now, those are the people, those farmers are the people who put your food on your table. They are the people. So I'm saying, is it a farmer's issue? It cannot be only a farmer's issue. Lawyers, doctors, teachers, students, journalists, every one of us are dependent on an economy with the farmers at its core, and agricultural laborers and women farmers. These people are at the core. Now, if we say that it's not our problem, it's their problem, A, that is stupid and short-sighted. Yeah? B, it's factually wrong. It is our problem. And I'm trying to tell people that you're also, by joining up, you're doing something for yourself. You're making yourself relevant to the large problems besetting the country. Yeah? So this is the idea, that solidarity groups are forming all over the country, which will assist the march in one way or the other. The mobilization is that of the farmers, and these groups are trying to mobilize the middle classes. So I envisage middle classes participating in that protest with non-partisan banners. Students for farmers, teachers for farmers, lawyers for farmers, doctors for farmers, theatre artists in Delhi have formed, theatre artists for farmers. They will perform all of November all over Delhi, and on the 3 days of the march they will be with the marchers performing. Musicians likewise. So I don't know, I think that the time is too short, but I believe there is huge interest in the public. So I know that a lot of people are calling me, writing to me, asking how they can participate. So we've set up a website, Dilli Chalo. And you can post in any language you like. You can write about what students are thinking about farmers. You can post on that. Our students' concern. The DU Beat article can go up there, but you can do more. You can write about, you can do articles from within the university community on, are people worried? Would they like to be part of this march? Would they like to show their solidarity?
Exactly, how does one break away from this bubble that we've created around ourselves of media, of leisure, of...
The only way of breaking away from the bubble is to prick the bubble. You burst that bubble. You know, it's like you are a bunch of young journalists here. The only way you ever write an article is to actually write. You spend a day agonizing before you write it, right?
Yes.
How am I going to write this? How do I start? Yeah. finally you are finally the article gets started when you the article, yeah, but finally the article gets started or gets begun when you figure out without articulating it that the only way to get back to writing is to write.
The only way to start is to start.
Remember, that is November 28th to 30th. I want to tell you what the demand of that march is. The central demand of the march is that we have a 21-day special session of parliament, a joint session of parliament, to show this nation's commitment to farmers and rural distress. 21 days, a special session of parliament by which focuses exclusively on agrarian crisis, on the agrarian crisis and related issues. So if you have 21 days, 3 days to discuss the Swaminathan report, Swaminathan Commission reports submitted between 2004 and 2006, and not a single day's discussion in Parliament in 14 years. 3 days to discuss the mega water crisis in the country. It's going to get worse. How do we deal with it? How, rather than transfer the crisis onto the backs of poor people at some point. 3 days to discuss rights and entitlements, and that is, by the way, the least popular demand in the Indian male. 3 days to discuss the rights and entitlements of women farmers. My understanding is that you haven't a hope in hell of solving the agrarian crisis if you do not engage with and address the issues of those who do the maximum work in agriculture. So you've got to look at Dalit farmers, women farmers and Adivasi farmers very specifically. 3 days to discuss the credit crisis, not just loan waiver, but how to have a proper structure of credit flows for agriculture. 3 days to discuss the issues of land reform, land acquisition, forcible acquisition of land, which is causing such great distress, collapse of livelihoods, migration. 3 days to discuss what kind of agriculture do we want 30 years from now, an agriculture driven by corporations or controlled by communities. So there are serious, and 3 days, just let the victims of the agrarian crisis stand on the floor of Central Hall of Parliament and address the nation on what the crisis means to them. No intermediaries, no journalists, no experts. Believe me, that is one time the nation will really want to know.